Today is June 12, 2008. I am Cassie Potasik, and it is a pleasure to conduct this interview for the Dakota Memories Oral History Project in Hazen, North Dakota. Can you please tell me your full name?
Donald Theodore Huber.
When and where were you born?
I was born 8-19-1929 here at Hazen, in a home here at Hazen.
Was there a midwife or a doctor present?
Why, I don't know how to answer that. I imagine a midwife, but I wouldn't know who or anything.
Right. Have you ever heard an interesting story about your birth?
No, I haven't, no.
Okay.
Wait a minute, I take that back. One story, yes. I weighed a little over 10 pounds when I was born. And my dad kidded me about that. He said, they didn't carry you out, you walked out, you were so big. That's right, I remember that, yes.
All right. Can you please share some of your earliest memories with us?
Oh, boy. Wow. I don't even know where to start. I don't. Honestly, I don't.
All right, then. Well, can you just tell me what a typical winter was like out here on the plains?
Well, the early winters, yeah, they were long, cold, and lots of snow.
Spring like?
Well, back in those days, it was before the Garrison Dam went in, when the snow started melting, we had flood threats here from the creek north of us and from the Knife River south of us. And there were times when the water got very high in this area, yes. But I don't ever remember it really flooding us here in town, but the surrounding areas it did. So,
right.
Outside of that, well, that was later on in life. I remember, I was old enough to drive truck. We hauled truckloads of sand into town to try and fight off the creek and stuff and stop it from. The creek south of town here, in town, but we all truckloads of sand and dumped it to Fort Dykes. And it didn't get away on us either, but it was close. Yeah, I remember those.
Okay.
Well, outside of that, I don't know. We went skating when we could, and we usually... Well, sometimes we flooded our old skating rig, and this creek on the northwest corner of town, we skated on that a few times. Take old tires down there and burn them, so it helped keep us warm. I remember that, yes. Outside of that, I don't remember much,
What was summer like?
Well, summer. We went down to the Knife River, go swimming whatever we could. I remember a time when a girl pulled me out of the Knife River. I was drowning. She reached in and grabbed me by the hair and pulled me out of a... Actually, it was a drop-off. I fell into it. And I remember the girl's name. Her last name was Reichenberg, but I can't remember the first name. And I caught particular heck when I got home because I wasn't supposed to be swimming. That I do remember, yes. Outside of that, it was just normal things, I guess. Biking, whatever we could, running around. I spent... a lot of time out at, well, this was somewhat later, but out at Alther Ted Hoover's farms. And, I remember riding a team of horses raking hay. Of course, I was, late in grade school at that time, but I remember the only thing they used the tractor for was to cut the hay. And we did the raking with horses, stacking with horses. Yeah, I remember those days. And then later in the fall, I remember pitching bundles. While before that, running a tractor later, then when I got a little bit older, not much, running a tractor, pulling a binder, which my uncle was sitting on, and then we shocked the grain, and then later on we hauled bundles, and I remember thrashing. That was, hauling the bundles at that time out there was all done by horses. And it was quite a large group, because there were four or five farms together that had bought a thrash machine, and we usually had like eight teams hauling, and then they had what they call spikers, field pitchers, to help load the loads. I remember those things well. I was a teenager then. Well, I was 13 when I first started pitching bundles that I can remember. That used to be fun. Had a good time doing those things. And, well, another thing my uncle Ted insisted on is that I learned how to milk cows. And that was unusual for a town kid. But I remember sitting out in the barn, and he usually did milk. He was using the field or doing something else. And anyway, that particular time he was milking, he said, "Why aren't you milking?" I said, "I don't know how." Well, that's when I learned how to milk. He said, "As of now, you're going to learn how." And I did. Yes. Many times after that. So that carried on even after I was married the first time. My father-in-law, south of Zap, we were out there one time, and then he said, well, they only milked a few cows, but he said he had to go milk. I said, "I can help you milk. What do you know about milking?" I said, "I milked a lot more cows than you got in the barn." He didn't want to believe me, but I did. And of course, one of the things, you know, when I was a kid growing up, most homes in town did not have sewer water. And a lot of them didn't. And I remember when we lived with my grandmother Basler, that we had to pump the water outside and carry it in by hand when my mother washed clothes. And they had this big old copper, what do they call it? Well, tub like deal, setting on the old wood burning stove or coal burning stove. Carry that full of water, the reservoir on that kitchen stove, and kerosene lamps. Yeah. I remember those days well, when you think about it. Even the coal, there was just a little cellar below that big house, and had a haul of coal in from a shed out near the alley. That was one of my chores. And we had chickens. On Saturdays, I would go out of town here a ways, like in the wintertime with my sled and a couple gunny sacks, get gunny sacks of straw, bring them in for the chickens. That was another one of my jobs, and to feed the chickens and stuff. Yeah, brings back lots of memories. But it was something. Good old outdoor biffies. Yeah, many times through the years, people would talk about those Sears Roebuck catalogs, you know. That's what they were used for a lot. Yeah, we had, well, I don't remember what year it was. We finally had sewer and water in the house. And at that time, well, my dad was a plumber, but we dug a lot of sewer and water ditches by hand. He didn't have these fancy machines that they have, you know, or had later where they dug them for you. We dug them by hand. Yep. So, yeah. Brings back a lot of memories in a hurry.
What were some of the other chores that you had growing up?
Oh, man. I don't remember that very well. Well, just getting water, chicken, let's see. But we, I don't know, later, you know, when I got into high school, I played sports. I played football, I played basketball. I don't think I really had any, you know, chores that I had to do that I could remember offhand. I stayed pretty active in school. I was at plays. I don't know. I don't think I had any other things at that time I had to do. Like in the summertime, of course, I was out at my uncle's place. And so that's about it, I guess.
Well then, when you were growing up, what kinds of things did you do for fun?
As I was growing up, well, I suppose hunting and fishing would have to, hunting would have to get in there big time. I got my first shotgun when I was 14 years old. I already had a 22. I think I got my first 22 when I was 12. That was one of the big things for me, was hunting, and of course fishing, whatever I could. The Knife River, we went fishing a lot. My mother loved to fish, so we did that as often as we could. And when we could, we'd go to a show in town. So I think that was. Then as I got a little bit older, of course I worked out at the farms. And then after that, I worked with my dad plumbing quite a bit. So, yeah, that's about it there, I guess. Hunting and fishing were big and important to me.
Did you have any inside games that you played?
Well, we played cards, yeah. And like I said, one of the games I hated was Canasta. But I did learn how to play cribbage at quite an early age. My folks didn't play it, but, at pool. I got to be quite a pool player at one time. In fact, I worked for a pool hall. I played on the house, or for the house, so. And, then later on, I got into bowling a lot. I did a lot of bowling through the years.
All right. Do you remember any toys that you had when you were growing up?
Toys. Well, I remember Christmas when I was quite young. Times were really tough. I got a little car for a Christmas toy. And that was, oh man, that was big time. And my sister and I had a pair of roller skates together. We had a bike together. And that caused a few rifts between my sister and myself because, well, when she decided it was her turn, I thought it was my turn. But back in those days, well, funds were pretty short. So, and I remember I had a sled. That was a lot of fun. We used to go south of town here. Oh, what is it down there? A mile and a half, probably. They used to call it Bent's Hill. That was our big big fun in a winter time, sliding out of Bed's Hill. Yeah, we did that. And, of course, going skating at a creek, or on a creek. Yeah, and as I remember how old I was. There's a guy here in town had, half an acre of strawberries. And his grandson was about my best friend at that time. I worked up there a couple summers. And, pretty soon I was promoted from picking to transplanting. And it was, quite an experience because he taught us a lot of things, you know, how gardening and stuff. And one time I got into trouble, he had tree rows. And it was my turn. 1 week I had to mow, the next week his grandson did. Well, he forgot to tell me he had a grape arbor started in this one tree row. I cut it off slick and clean. And, of course, I caught particular heck for it. Well, I didn't know it was there. He forgot to tell me that, so. Yeah, I was a busy kid that way. I was. But I hated strawberries for many, many, many years. I hate raspberries to this day. He had a raspberry patch, I'd say maybe a third as big as this room. I had to pick him one time, his grandson the next time. But you couldn't walk through him and pick him. You had to pick him crawling through on your back. You picked them from the bottom. Because he always maintained going through, picking them from the top, you hurt the leaves, they don't produce as well. And he had some of the nicest raspberries, but I hate them to this day. I will not eat raspberries to this day because of that. Oh, I hated that job. And like I said, it took me years to eat strawberry skin. Yes. But it was a learning experience. He did learn how to work. That's one thing. So, yep.
What other activities did you take part in when you were growing up?
Well, chasing girls. That's normal, isn't it? Yeah, that kept the guy pretty busy too, you know.
How old were you when you started dating?
Now that's interesting. Oh, man. 12, 13, maybe? Yeah, I'd say that. Let's see. Oh, boy, yeah, about that time. Start getting serious about 17, see. No, we went as teenagers. We went to a lot of dances. The old Beulah Sheep Shed, they call it in those days. And then, of course, the Zapp Hall. Yeah, we went pretty regular. So, that's where I met my first wife, was at the Zapp Hall. And I guess that's when I finally started getting a little bit more serious about life.
How old were you when you met her?
Let's see. I know I was out of high school. Got to think here just a little bit. I believe 19. Yes. Because I was 20 when we got married. Just short of 21. And we were married 18 and a half years when I lost her.
Can you tell me about your house when you were growing up?
I'm going to think which Let's see, I just think a little. I don't really remember the crib, but except what I was told. And let's see. Well, we lived with my grandmother. No, before that, let's see. Well, we lived on Main Street, which is now Box's Bar. Of course, that building was torn out and rebuilt. It's a brick building now. But my folks had bought cream. They had a cream station in the front. And we lived in the quarters in the back of it. And, well, we didn't have sewer water. We had an outdoor miffy. That I remember. I was trying to think of what we did for water. I can't remember the well or anything. I can't. Maybe we had water. I'm not sure. But I know there was two bedrooms and the kitchen and a small, well, living room. And then, of course, the cream station was out front. Farmers would bring in their cream, and my mother and dad both, well, my dad mostly, tested and bought cream. And then later on, he got started in the plumbing business. And let's see. Boy, we lived in another little small house, and I vaguely remember, but let's see, when I graduated from high school, we lived with Grandma, and then my folks built their home. Of course, then we had sewer and water, so. And then I can't remember what year it was that my wife and I, well, my grandmother had a house alongside of my folks. It was just a small little house. And my two uncles owned it. I got that from them or bought it from them. And then we slid that house back to the alley and lived on it while we built our home. And it wasn't a large home. It was 24 by 30, that I remember. We had two bedrooms, full basement, kitchen and living room combination deal, a dining room. And, yeah, it wasn't a large home, but it was a comfortable home. So, and, well, I had that house when Sharon and I got married, and she and her mom had bought this house. Well, then after Sharon and I got together, then we were debating. This house was a bit larger than mine over there, just a couple blocks away. So we sold that one and moved over here. So then this one had two finished bedrooms in the basement and two upstairs. So that's how I wound up here, I guess. Lived here since, 1970. Yeah, when Sharon and I got married. Shortly after we got married, we moved over here. So. All right. So.
When you were growing up, where did you take baths?
Oh, well, to start with, in a big old round tub, galvanized tub. We had no indoor plumbing. So it was just, Saturday night deal, I guess, or Saturday afternoon deal. In a big old round tub. Old galvanized tub. Yeah, we churned our own butter, too. We had a butter churn, and that was one of my chores as I was growing up. Saturday morning churning butter, that's right. Yes. That does, and we had that butter churned for years, and you know, just the other day somebody was telling me they churned butter. And it got me to thinking whatever happened to our butter churn. With your glass jug and a turned butter with it. I have no one to ask anymore. Folks are gone, sister's gone, so. But, yes.
Did your family have a large garden?
Oh, yes. Yes, it's over at Grandma's house there, yes. Let's see, when we lived uptown, we did know. There was no garden spot in the back that I could remember, but my grandparents had, well, actually an extra lot, you know, alongside of theirs. That was all garden. Yes. Yeah, we had a huge garden. When my folks built their home, the whole backyard was garden too. And then when Sharon and I got married, this backyard here was all garden. And then one year we rented an extra lot just for potatoes. But I got sick and tired of that. All we did was hoed spuds and kill bugs. And we had enough spuds to feed half the town. I said, no, that's... So we got out of that. Now we don't do any gardening anymore, so... But I used to love to garden. I did.
So. When you were growing up, what foods did you grow in the garden?
All everything. Potatoes, corn, peas, lettuce, radishes, carrots. Oh, man. What am I forgetting? About everything. Yeah, that's, yes. But every garden thing, and then of course, flowers. My mother loved flowers, and my first wife did too, and Sharon does. She has flowers out front here.
Who usually prepared the meals when you were growing up?
Mom.
And what were some of your favorites?
Oh boy, when I was growing up. Well, most any kind of food that didn't have raisins in it. And there's a reason for that. You see, when I was quite young, we played hide-and-go-seek at our house one night, or one day. And Mom and Dad had a little cabinet, you know, with spices and stuff. Well, I was a little guy. I climbed in there, and they couldn't find me. And you know, I ate almost a pound of raisins. And again, I don't like raisins to this day. I think I was sick for a week. Yes, and you could ask Sharon. When she fixes something, I try to tell her to keep the raisins out of it. I still don't like them. And let's see, what did I mean? Of course, I've always liked like Fleischkekle and Fleischstepf and things like that. I still do. I still like it. And I've been a chocolate hound for many, many years. Chocolate cake, chocolate pudding, chocolate ice cream, you name it, anything with chocolate. But the last few years, one of my favorites has been anything with juneberries. One of my favorite things is Sharon will make pancakes with juneberries in them. And, before they left for Vegas just a couple of weeks ago, she baked a juneberry pie for me. And I made that last almost a week. So then she baked three of them, three juneberry pies and an apple pie. But she gave away two blueberry pies and apple pie. Yeah. That didn't agree with me too all the way either, but I put up with it. What choice have I got? I used to like to cook some meals. But I don't know, I guess after so many surgeries and stuff, well, I just got lazy. And Sharon spoiled me, so. Yeah. What did I fix last week one night? Oh. Well, sometimes she comes home from work. A lot of times she's pretty tired. So I opened a can of tomato soup, and I make it with milk. She says it's as good or better with water, but I don't agree. I still like it with milk. And then I fixed some toasted cheese sandwiches, and she appreciated that. But I used to, we have our own sausage and stuff, but we make our own. So, but I don't know. I just don't get the comfort anymore. She's got me too spoiled. I have to admit that, so.
When you were growing up, did you ever help in the kitchen?
Not unless I absolutely had to. Maybe washing dishes, and that was terrible for me. I still don't like to wash dishes, but I do once in a great while. And then after Sharon and I got married, well, we had two households of stuff. What are you going to do? Well, we got rid of some of it and gave some away, sold some, and then, well, we had gotten, you know, quite a bit of money, so we bought a dishwasher, portable dishwasher. Sharon didn't like it. It was too noisy for her. So sought living in Minneapolis. At that time, he came home and he says, "Where's your dishwasher?" I said, "Down in the fruit room." He took it with him. Whatever happened to it, I don't know to this day. But, and we just, you know, to put in a good dishwasher, our kitchen's so small. And we've been redoing our kitchen, I think, for 20 years, but it still has never been done. Yeah. Sharon, well, I maybe shouldn't say that, but sometimes it takes her a while to make up her mind, see. So, and I've said many times, Sharon, don't throw anything away. That's why I'm still here. See, she hasn't thrown me out yet. I've given her reason to, I have, but... So, but 38 years is a long time. So?
Well, you mentioned that you liked ice cream. Did your family make their own when you were growing up?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Do you remember how?
Man, if you had time, we could make some right now. We still have a hand crank freezer. We have an electric freezer. And yes, whatever we get the opportunity, yes, we love to make ice cream. But the biggest thing with our family, we make our own sausage. And we used to make a lot of sausage. And last fall, I don't hunt deer anymore, but... two of the grandsons, the grandson's dad. Anyway, they went deer hunting. We cut up our own meat, and we're very fussy, very, very fussy with it. And this year is the first year that we did our own mixing. The grandson's dad got a hold of a mixer. Some guy made himself. It's a wonderful unit. We mixed our old meat. We added pork to the fry sausage and the farmer's sausage. We added beef to it. And I got both out in the deep freeze right now. Yep. So we have a lot of fun doing it. That's some of the pictures I should have showed you. Yeah, everybody gets involved. My uncle, he's been gone now for a few years, but some years ago he bought a sausage stuffer. It's a big one with us. It's a stainless steel unit. And even a kid could turn the crank on it. And they enjoy doing it. And, well, the women, I tell them, well, now it's your turn for a while. And so we have fun. We usually do it here in the kitchen. And I think last year it was somewhat over 200 pounds we made. But we used to make, well, I know the one year we made like 400 pounds. So, but it's nice to have through the years, you know. Just go out in the deep freezing. So, yeah, we do that too, so. But the only thing I hunted this past year is I went goose hunting once. My oldest grand, I used to do a lot of it, but my oldest grandson took me out. And we were out, I don't know what, hour and a half, and we had 6 geese on the ground. It was just one of those mornings where everything was just perfect. And, yeah, we had a great time, so. Yeah. Nope.
Now, you've mentioned several times that you didn't have running water when you were growing up.
No. Oh.
Do you remember getting electricity and running water?
Well, I was trying to think. I just don't remember. I know we had electricity, I don't remember that exactly either. Yes, Grandma had electricity in her house. It was a two-story house, but not all of it. See, there was no basement under that house. It was just a cellar. But I know we moved from there to another house that didn't have a sewer water, but then when the folks built their home, yeah, we dug the, well, the city had water lines all over then, and we dug the sewer ditch by hand. It was, well, what would it be, rough, right close to 100 feet of ditch we dug by hand, back to the alley, into the house. See? And then the water lines are out on the street. And we dug that by hand too. See, this house where I live in now, looking at a bird. When this house was built here, the same contractor built the house on both sides of us, and there was 2 water lines serviced 3 homes. Now, if you try to turn the water off on the house south of us, you can't unless you turn the water off on our house. Because that's how they were hooked up way back then. And this house here, when I played football across the street, the football field, this house was not here then. And even now, well, when the house was built, the water came from the street south of here. But now there is a water line out on the street east of us. It's, yeah. But I don't remember when. I know the WPA days. It was a government project, and I know my dad did some work on it as a plumber. But I don't remember. I was quite a kid. But WPA was Workman's Progress, something like that. But people called it We Poke Along. That was a term that was used back in those days. But I remember some of those days, but I guess I could have looked it up or should have looked it up on years that went. But see, that's how some of the sewer and water lines got started in this town. So,
do you remember the CCCs at all?
The what?
The CCCs?
Oh, yes. It was, well, I was a kid, but I knew some of the guys that worked for the CCC, you know, or were in the program. But it was, before my time, yeah. But some of the guys that were involved in it, yes. In fact, a good friend of mine passed away this past year, and I know he mentioned it at one time that quite a few guys back in a few years ago were involved in that program from around here. Yeah?
What else do you remember about the Dirty 30s?
Oh, Well, one thing I remember, you know, it doesn't seem possible, but I can remember swarms of grasshoppers, you know, that, but that had to be in the later 30s or early 40s. And, well, then they tried to poison the grasshoppers, and they used big round barrels with poison in it, and they scattered it on their fields. But what it did, it killed many, many birds. You know, when they ate that, it killed them. It didn't only kill the grasshoppers, it killed everything. So I vaguely remember some of that stuff, but yeah. And that had to be, Kyle, I don't know, that had to be in the 40s sometime. Or late 30s, early 40s, yeah. And I can remember, well, two of my uncles lived in these big old sod houses. You know, they had walls 2 feet, 2-3 feet thick. But none of those are setting. They tore them down, you know, as time went by. But I know the Basler homestead, my aunt and uncle lived in one out there for many years, and well, now there's two relatively new homes out there that, well, my cousin and her husband built a home there, and then their son built quite a large home out there. And now I don't even know if anybody's living in that first one, because I know both of them have died, so I have no idea if they're still.
All right. Yep. Did you ever experience any dust storms?
Dust storm? I can't remember. Actually, I can't. But I know that, like, east of town, there's a lot of sand. And I could remember the sand being as high as the fences, you know. But that supposedly happened maybe when I was just a small kid. They call it the sand hills out east of Hazen here. But they also said when I was, well, living at Kreb, or we were, and I was like 4 or 5, I don't remember it actually, but I know my folks told me about it, that a cyclone went through there, and that's a big bad windstorm. And there supposedly was a church right close to where we lived, and the storm completely destroyed that church. At our house, it took a couple bricks out of the chimney. That was it. So, but I remember being out at my my grandparents' homestead, when my aunt and uncle lived there, when one of these storms came by, and it picked up a hay rack, or, you know, just moved it along, maybe for a couple hundred yards, faster than I've ever seen one move. But it was just in that short area. That I remember, yes. So, but dust storms, well, even the last few years would have been so dry. You've had enough of them around here, yes. In fact, earlier this spring, there was some dust storms. Not like back in the 30s, but it was dry. It was very dry here. Now, of course, it's pretty good again, so.
Is there anything else you remember about the Dirty 30s?
No, except, you know, what I was told, but as personal remembering it, no. I remember times were tough. That I do remember. Finances were very tough. And, but it seemed like it affected the biggest percentage of the people. You know, everybody was going through it. And I heard a lot of different stories, but to actually, see, I was born in 29, so it was, all the early 40s, things start popping pretty good again. So I don't remember too much of that, except a few years there where, well, like I mentioned earlier, I remember that one Christmas, I got a little car toy. That was all for Christmas. And we had no Christmas tree. And my sister, if I remember right, got a little doll. But that was it, you know, just money was doggone scarce. And I don't remember. I know, from what I've read and heard, like crops are just, you know, 4 or 5 bushels an acre and stuff, if they got that, so, at that time, so.
Yeah. Well, you've mentioned Christmas. Can you tell me more about how your family celebrated it when you were a child?
Well, to a point, as time progressed and got things a little bit better, yeah, but I remember that year I just mentioned, we had no Christmas tree, and, but after that, yeah, we always had a Christmas tree, and, I just don't remember. I know there was some families that used candles because they didn't have lights, you know, for their trees and stuff. But I can't remember if we, I don't believe we had candles. I think we always had, you know, a few lights on it, but not like, of course, this day and age. But yeah, and then of course, after times got a little bit better, I remember the folks would have a whole drawer full of combination of like peanuts and walnuts and almonds, and all in one big drawer. And man, we'd eat on them all winter long. I don't know, it's just like a tradition. And then usually Bob would fix a big Christmas dinner, if possible. And usually, well, at Christmas it was turkey. No, Thanksgiving it was turkey. And at Christmas it was usually like ham. If they could afford it. Well, years later you could, but. And then sometimes. There was, golly, what, 4 or 5, maybe 6 of the aunts and uncles lived on farms. So. Sometimes a turkey from there, or maybe a piece of pork or something, you know, to carry over. Yeah. And Edward, we lived with Grandma. Like I said, we had our own chickens. And we had the eggs and stuff, so. And during hunting season, well, we always had plenty of wild game, so.
Santa Claus when you were younger?
Well, you had to. Otherwise, you got nothing. But then when you got older, well, then you faked it, see? Yes, I went through that. Easter Bunny, Santa Claus, oh, man, yes. Worked good.
Can you tell me how your family celebrated Easter?
One of the big things, of course, was well, just like Christmas, you went to church and had a meal, and I was, getting back to Christmas, I was, golly, let's see, when I was in fifth grade, I know at the Christmas program at the church at that time, I served as a preacher for 2 years. And that was kind of fun. Yeah, I remember that. And then you had, your Christmas program and stuff and Christmas bags. You know, churches still do that around here. The little kids get a Christmas sack with peanuts and candy in it and stuff. And yeah, that was always a big thing. They still do it up here. Yeah, still a tradition.
Right.
Yeah. And I remember when our kids, of course, we weren't flush with money either, but Well, we got whatever we could. All those pictures, some of those. I remember the one year we got the boys each a bike. I don't know. I'll bet you those pictures went with their out boy, because I've always kind of remembered that. And then after Sharon and I got married, well, things had gotten a lot better, but I remember my son Mark and her son EJ, we got them each at 22. And buried it right in a Christmas tree, you know, stuck it in there. And then one year here, and each one of us has gone through it. They get the bright idea of leaving little notes and you had to go find your Christmas present. My daughter Dorothy was quite an instigator to that. And one year, I told Dorothy to get Sharon a nice new coat. And I gave her, I thought, pretty good chunk of money. She called me and said it wasn't enough. Anyway, here at the Christmas, there was a little box. It gave directions. Well, she wound out on the street. Her car was parked on the street. In the trunk of her car, she found her Christmas present. And one year, they got me a TV set. I was in every room of the house that was downstairs in a fruit room. That's where I wound up. So we've had a lot of fun with that. Yes, we have. Yeah.
All right. When you were a child, did your family celebrate the 4th of July?
Sometimes. Yes, we, well, let's see. What did we do? I remember going to, well, a couple rodeos, yes. Yeah. And let's see, at that time, well, the carnivals, they used to have a few carnivals around too. A lot of times, well, you visited relatives too. See, a lot of them were on farms, and so. Yeah, it's. I don't know, not the greatest. Of course, as I got a little bit older, I went off by myself, you know, and other things. So.
All right.
And then, let's see. Well, my oldest grandson, he's been real active in demolition derbies. We went to, well, this was later, of course, we went to a couple of them, but sometimes it's wind and dust and dirt that I quit going to them, smashing up each car, you know. Did you ever go to one? You did. Did you drive in one? Did you? My oldest grandson, he was just wild about it. He could hardly wait for him. In fact, the other day he was talking about getting a car for this year. They usually have one up at Beulah, so. But I don't go anymore. And one year I about died in the dust and dirt, so. But we used to go fishing and picnics and stuff a lot of times, so. We did that a lot, yes.
Did your family celebrate any other holidays when you were young?
No, not really. Well, like, you know, Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter, 4th of July. No, not really.
You celebrate New Year's?
Not till later than I did, of course. We were invited to New Year's parties, yes. But when I was younger, of course, that was just for the grown-ups. So and when I got a little bit older, you didn't want to go to their parties. We had our own. I remember a few of them. Yeah.
What did you do at your own parties?
Well, sang songs. No, we generally had enough to drink, so let's put it that way, because be honest. And there was always a New Year's Eve dance. And I remember one year in high school, we had a basketball tournament shortly after New Year's. It was like the, third or fourth. And our coach told us he did not want us to go to any New Year's Eve dance. Well, we knew how he always checked. At 9:30 or 10 o'clock, he'd show up at the dance hall. And all he had to do is look out on the street at the cars. That's where we were sitting watching him. And then when he left, we went back in. So, yeah. And then one year at Beulah, he celebrated with us. Yeah. I remember that night real well, yep. Oh, we were no little angels by any means, so I don't claim to be one to this day.
All right. When you were a child, did your family celebrate birthdays?
Oh, yes. Yeah, whatever we could. We always did that. We always had birthday parties, yes.
Can you describe a birthday party?
Well, I guess it was just, you know, if possible, they played, you know, you'd play games and then you'd have cake and ice cream and open a few gifts and stuff, you know, just a fun time is what it was. Yes. Yeah, we were at a birthday party just this past Sunday, my son-in-law's. So we still try to do that. We're invited to one this coming Sunday. At my son-in-law's, one of his older daughters, their five-year-old, is having a birthday up at Beulah. We got an invitation just yesterday. And Sharon says, what are we going to do? I said, I know what you mean. We got about four other things going on. And my son called the other day from Bismarck. He said, Dad, going to bring my boat up and I'm going to take you fishing on Father's Day. But I said, I don't think I want to go. I got too many other things to do. So I can't sit in that position very long. My left leg gives me a lot of trouble, a lot of pain. So I'm going to call him. He should be coming home from Chicago. Now, his mother said, maybe tonight, I don't know. So I don't bet on that until he calls. But I know last night he called, he said he was at the Chicago Cub Atlanta Braves baseball game. So had to sit and watch the baseball game. She thought maybe we could spot him. There was only like 42,000 people at the game. And he told us where he was sitting. 40 rows back on a third base side. How are you going to spot somebody? But we watched the game. I've been a Braves fan for many years, so I sat in my comfortable chair, and she sat in her chair, and so it was fun. Yeah. When my grandson called, what are you doing, Grandpa? I bet you're sitting in your chair. Yep, usually. That's where I spent a lot of time, in that chair over there. So.
Right. Well, one thing we haven't talked about very much yet is your grade school. So can you tell me about going to school?
Oh, man. That's a long time ago. I know I was at ordinary little level. I got into numerous fights and scrapes. I did that, but and I didn't mind so much catching heck from the superintendent or my teacher. When I got home, that's when hell started. Oh, that was the bad time, especially if my mother found out about it. Wow. Dad would kind of chuckle it off a little bit, but not my mother. And then when I was, I think it was the sixth grade, I got my first D. And wow, you know that I never left the house in the evening for 6 weeks. That was my mother's rule. I couldn't go to shows. And I tell you, I think I knew that book by heart by then. All it was laziness, you know, and I, So, but I went to school at Beulah 1 year. And that was, what grade was that? It was either the fifth or sixth. No, it was the seventh grade I got. That was at a sixth grade. I was so small, short. When I went to Beulah, they didn't believe that I should be in the sixth grade. So my teacher decided she was going to keep me in the fifth until they transferred my grades from Hazen to Beulah. And that seems like at that time it was a, I don't know, like an act of God almost, because it took a couple weeks. Well, all that stuff in the fifth grade, I knew that stuff. So I finally got my grades. But one of the things when I went to school up there, some of those kids up there thought I should root for the Beulah sports teams. And I would never do that. To this day, I wouldn't. And I was in more fights that year than I think I was at all the rest of the grade school at Hazen. Because I just absolutely wouldn't do it. And I got enough scraps down here, too, but,
How were you disciplined by your teachers?
Oh, they would just threaten this or that. And, we had to go up to the office. And, the superintendent, they had a little rubber hose there, but never used it. That their part wasn't bad at all. But going home was bad, because you weren't usually beat you home very often. Though, I know the one time I hit a kid in the face, and I don't know, I had to stay after school a couple of weeks, but I walked by the kid and he made some smart remark, and I turned around and hit him in the face, knocked the tooth out, and so I stayed after school for a couple of weeks, but then a couple of weeks later, his sister cold cocked me with a dinner bucket from behind. Oh, man, did she deck me. But she got off. Yeah, so I remember that, too. And then one time, when we lived up at the creep station, kids would come up there. We played cops and robbers. And this one kid, we really didn't like him. He wanted to play. Well, we tied him to one of these highlight poles, and we all went home. Well, I lived the closest, you know, but supper time, here is his mother. Where's Arnold at? Oh, my God, I remembered. We tied him to that pole, you know, out back a ways. And there he was. Yeah, I was in trouble that time for quite a while with my mother. Too, but can you imagine, we forgot about the kid. So I was no little angel, I will admit that. But I was no devil either, not completely.
All right. Would you bring your lunch to school or would you go home?
Oh, no, we went home all the time, yes. Well, I only lived, downtown, two and a half blocks. See, at that time, they didn't have lunch programs. And the kids that came a distance, they carried lunch buckets, their own lunch buckets. But no, I usually went home to eat every meal at, dinner time.
What subjects were you taught in school?
Well, a grade school? Well, they call it arithmetic. Reading, writing, penmanship. I got bad handwriting to this day. I could never master that, it seemed like. And then as you advanced, of course, your topic, history, which I'd ever liked, English, here and there, and well, let's see, as we advanced in years, we had driver's ed, but I never took a driver's test. I was driving, I came to town, I was out at my uncle's. I came into town, I brought a load of weed into town with a truck. Took it over the elevator, over the elevator. I loaded it, I stopped at my folks's. And my dad said, well, how did you come into town? I said, I brought a load of weed in. You don't have a driver's license? I said, you don't need one. Oh, yes, you do. So I had to stay in, and the next morning my dad took me up to, it was a Marlon Murray garage, and at that time all he had to do was sign for me and I had a driver's license. I never took a driver's test in my life. And later on, you know, kids or people would say, well, where'd you get your driver's license, Sears Roebuck? I said, no, I did better than that, so. But we took driver's test, our driver's ed, but never took an exam. And in high school, I took all the math I could. I love math. That's one thing I really liked. So, and then after high school, I had signed up to go to Wahpeton, to trade school, but I never went. I got a job here in town, and when that was done in late fall, I went to work for REA at that time. And like I said, I had a pretty neat girlfriend, and that had quite a bit to do with it, so I never did go to college. In the first place, at the time, I didn't think my folks could afford to send me to college. And I didn't really know if I wanted to go to college. I was having too much fun otherwise. So that's my sister went to college. She went to Dickinson. They got a 2-year teaching certificate at that time. And she taught school for a number of years around here, but I taught 1 year right out of high school. And it was a sad situation because the school board just didn't have any money to work with. And I know my sister came out there and she helped me make out a book order. And I got one book. I started the first part of December and I was already the fifth teacher in that school. And she came out and helped me make out a book order. Well, that year, I got one new book, and it was a library book. I learned how tough these kids really had it. Some of the rural schools. It was a shame, but you know, to teach a school right out of high school, wow. Yeah, it was. Well, it was quite a learning experience, it was. So,
how important was education to your family?
Well, way back then, not that important, not like it is this day and age. My sister was, I believe, one of the first to go to college that I can remember, or one of the earliest ones to go to college. And I just... it just didn't seem that important to people. Now, the people that, could well afford it, see, that was a different situation. But, see, neither one of my parents ever went to high school. I don't think either one of them ever finished eighth grade back in those days. So, yeah, I was... really a whole different world back in those days. It was. You learned mostly from experience, I guess, and what Mom and Dad said. That was it. Yeah. And I know a lot of my cousins that have never went to high school. I think I could sit down and name quite a few right off the bat, you know. So, but
all right. Can you tell me what your happiest childhood memory is?
Wow. Happiest childhood memory. Man, oh man, oh man, oh man. Well, I could tell you what, yes. I was not a small child. How old was I at that time? I was 11 or 12, I would say that. I had my sights, and I was trying to save up to buy a .22. And when I thought I had enough money accumulated, I went up to get it at a hardware store. And you know what? It had been sold. Oh, was I down in the dumps. When my birthday came around here, my dad had bought it. Yes. I think that's one of my earliest happy moments. And, well, going back before that, the times that I spent with this dog I showed you pictures of. The guy that had the Hazel Lumber store at that time, well, it was Klein Lumber at that time. They lived, we had lived alongside of them, and when we moved, they were good friends. And he heard about my dog, what he could do up at the school grounds. And at that time, he had a movie camera, you know, which was unheard of to most people because that was an expensive toy. And he came up to school and he shot movies of my dog and myself. I saw him once. Well, he died, and then his wife moved out of here, and somewhere along the line, these things disappeared. These movies disappeared, and I always wanted them, but I have no idea what ever happened to them. But yeah, that was a big time for me when he showed these movies to our class. That was me and my dog. Yes. So I don't know. I guess I had numerous happy times, yes. Had a lot of downtime, too. I mean, that's...
Childhood experience?
Actually, I think when Grandpa Basler died, I was quite young at that time, and he was very close and dear to me. And it just, for years, I could remember when we'd go up to their place, walk up to their place. And he had the habit, you'd sit on his lap, and he'd always give you a whisker rub. And then he'd say something in German to you. And I remember when I went out to the cemetery, it did bother me, but on the way into town, I just went boom. Yeah, I think that was, yeah. So... I can't think of anything, you know, beyond that. Of course, there were numerous other ones as I got older, but, with my brother, and then, of course, losing my wife so young. She was only 36 years old when she died. So that was very distressful, too. So,
the most adventurous thing you did as a child?
Wow. Well, you know, just thinking quickly, golly, this pamphlet or booklet I showed you when this pastor murdered this woman or young gal, sometime after that, my parents took us down to the North Dakota State Penitentiary. And we went through, at that time they made binder twine down there. And it was a horrible, horrible smell. And I think seeing him in that penitentiary that time, you know, it was, what would you say? Kind of tough, and yet it was good, because they had found this girl was, 14 at the time? She was pregnant. He burned the house down and killed her in it, and things like that, you know, yes. So, I don't know. And that, you know, at that time, to go to Bismarck, that was a whole day trip. You know, you didn't have vehicles like you do now. You didn't have roads like you do now. And man, that was quite an adventure when you got to go to Bismarck. And of course, it was the same thing when you went out for lunch. It was a hamburger and a milkshake. Yeah. That was a big deal at that time, yes. But I don't know. I didn't really do much traveling until after Sharon and I were married. I had never been to Montana before Sharon and I were married. I had been to, I had been to Minneapolis a couple of times and did very little traveling before that. But since then, well, we've been in a few different places. She's done a lot more than I have, but I'm not a much of a traveler to begin with. I'm a homeboy. I'd rather be at home. That's right. We went to Dallas. Yeah, she came off work and said she had an opportunity to go to Dallas for some seminar with her job. So I said she should grab it, and then we would go. When she was done with that, we'd go to Houston to visit the son, which we did. But I don't know, about the second day we were at Houston, my son said, "Well, how come you're always looking north?" Well, I said, "In a day or so, that's where I'm headed, and that's where I'm going to stay." So that meant go home. And that's, we were in Seattle, and the same way, 2-3 days, I'm ready to go home. So maybe that's one of the reasons I don't really like to go to Vegas either, because I've always been a homeboy, so I like it right here, my house.
Why do you think it's important to tell your life story?
Well, I don't know if it is or not. Maybe somebody else can learn something from experiences or, you know, improve on failures or something. I'm not sure. I really am not. I know some time ago, our youngest son asked about the Hoover background and stuff and family, and I hope somebody picks it up from here. Now, and especially to the Basler side. The Basler side is not as complete as the Hoover side, and I kind of hope somebody goes beyond that. And I don't know if I kid or not, but I hope somebody does, so. Because I'm not getting any younger.
All right. Are there any other thoughts thoughts or observations you'd like to share with us?
No, not really. I guess I enjoyed you two, both of you. It was fun.
Well, we enjoyed it too. Thank you so much for doing this.
Well, as I said, I wish Sherrod could have been in on a little more of it. She's been very inspirational in this thing. She has, and it's meant a lot to me. So, and I have to admit, I don't know what the devil I'd do without her. So, we have, no question, we have our ups and downs, but still, you know, 38 years is a long time. So, you know, that's...
All right.
Yeah.